ਵਾਹਿਗੁਰੂ ਜੀ ਕਾ ਖਾਲਸਾ, ਵਾਹਿਗੁਰੂ ਜੀ ਕੀ ਫਤਿਹ। ਗੁਰਮੁਖ ਪਿਆਰਿਓ, ਦਿਸ ਕਮੈਂਟਰੀ ਕਮਸ ਟੂ ਯੂ ਇਨ ਦਾ ਫੋਰਮ ਆਫ ਅ ਸੀਰੀਜ਼ ਆਫ ਆਡੀਓਸ ਦੈਟ ਵਿਲ ਅਟੈਂਪਟ ਟੂ ਐਸਟੈਬਲਿਸ਼ ਦ ਬੇਸਿਕ ਪ੍ਰਿੰਸੀਪਲਸ ਵਿਚ ਵੀ ਕੈਨ ਅਪਲਾਈ ਇਨ ਹੈਲਪਿੰਗ ਅਸ ਅੰਡਰਸਟੈਂਡ ਗੁਰਬਾਣੀ। ਨਾਉ ਈਚ ਆਡੀਓ ਇਜ਼ ਡਿਵੋਟਡ ਟੂ ਵਨ ਬੇਸਿਕ ਪ੍ਰਿੰਸੀਪਲ। ਆਫਟਰ ਐਸਟੈਬਲਿਸ਼ਿੰਗ ਦ ਪ੍ਰਿੰਸੀਪਲ, ਅ ਫੋਲੋ ਅਪ ਆਡੀਓ ਵਿਲ ਅਟੈਂਪਟ ਟੂ ਅਪਲਾਈ ਦ ਪ੍ਰਿੰਸੀਪਲ ਟੂ ਸ਼ਬਦਸ ਫਰੋਮ ਦ ਸ੍ਰੀ ਗੁਰੂ ਗ੍ਰੰਥ ਸਾਹਿਬ ਜੀ। And this is the second audio in this series. The principle that we are discussing is the Rahau principle. The basic elements of the Rahau principle were established in audio 1. This audio will make better sense if you have already listened to audio 1. So let's begin by summarizing the basic ingredients of the Rahau principle that we discussed in audio 1. First, Rahau does not mean pause. In the context of the message of the Shabad, the Rahau verse is the one that contains the essence of the message. So Rahau means the essence, Rahau means the gist, it means the core, and Rahau means the central idea of the Shabad. Second, an accurate understanding of the Rahau verse must be obtained first, so as to derive a more accurate understanding of the remaining verses of the Shabad. This is because it is the Rahau verse that is exemplified and expanded in the remaining verses of the Shabad. Third, it is the Rahau verse that ties in all the non-Rahau verses. The Rahau verse is the unifying verse, the nucleus verse, the central verse that connects all the non-Rahau verses into one holistic message. It follows, therefore, that understanding a Shabad must begin with comprehending the Rahau verse. To further establish the above elements of the Rahau principle, let us try to apply them to an illustrative example, a sort of a made-up example, or what we call a make-believe example, before we apply them to an actual Shabd from Gurbani. Our illustrative or make-believe example will have four verses. Let's say that the first verse reads, "A green apple falls to the ground." The second verse reads, "The most challenging task of an airplane is in the takeoff." The third verse reads, "The earth's spin is a productive one." Now, the first thing we notice is that all these verses appear disjointed, unconnected to one another, and not making sense in terms of continuity. The first is about an apple falling, the second about an airplane taking off, and the third about the earth spinning on its own axis. Now, beginner students of Gurbani usually have this complaint. They see the verses of the Shabad as disjointed, as unconnected, and having little or no continuity at all. They are therefore at a loss to connect them all together into one single coherent message. Now, the second thing we notice from the illustrative make-believe or made-up example above is that if we took the verses one at a time and tried to make sense of them, we could virtually make anything we wanted out of them. Take the first verse, yeah? "A green apple falls to the ground." We could take the color and expound on it and say there is something very special about the color green. That's why it's mentioned. We could say it was the author's favorite color, so we should all wear green. We could say the apple was the author's favorite fruit, so we should all eat apples. Now, the interpretations are virtually limitless. Now, this is the other complaint about Gurbani, Katha, Vichar, and Discourse. Many a time, our ragis, our kirtaniyas, and our kathakars take a single verse and make just about anything out of it to establish a point of their personal choosing, which is why we should never attempt to use single verses from Gurbani. We should be suspicious of those who insist on taking just one or two verses and trying to explain very major spiritual principles to us based on that one or two single verses. More often than not, people who do so are using Gurbani as a tool to establish their own personal points. So how do we make sense of it all? Now, to understand that, let's get back to the illustrative make-believe example. Recall that it had four verses. The first verse said that a green apple falls to the ground. Now, the second, that the most challenging task of an airplane is in the takeoff. The third verse said that the earth spin is a productive one. Now imagine that the fourth verse is the Rahav verse, and it reads, gravity is the force that draws objects towards the earth, Rahav. You will see that now everything falls in place. All the verses get connected to each other by virtue of their connection to the gravity verse or the Rahav verse in our make-believe example. So the discourse would be now that the green apple falls to the ground due to gravity. The airplane's takeoff is the most challenging part because it has to break away from gravity. And the third verse that reads, the earth's spin is a productive endeavor, would not require speculative debate over what was meant by the words productive endeavor, because this is clarified in the Rahav verse, which was the gravity verse. We know for certain now that the productive endeavor referred to is gravitational force, which was the product of the spinning, and not to some other arbitrary kind of a force. The gravity verse also removes the possibility of wrong interpretations. We now know that the words green apple or the color green had no real significance, even though we could have ended up making a huge mountain out of these two words. Gurmukh Pyareyo, now let's examine how we can apply the Rahav principle to a Shabad from Gurbani. The Shabad we will discuss is by Bhagat Kabir ji, and it appears on page 870 of the Sri Guru Granth Sahib ji. Gond, naru marai nar kaamna yaavai, pasu marai das kaaj savare. Apne karam ki gat main kya jaano babare Rahav. Haad jale jaise lakri ka tula, केस जले जैसे कास का पूला, काओ कबीर तब ही नर जागे, जम का डंड मूंड में लागे. सो लेट्स टेक द फर्स्ट टू वर्सेस. नरु मरे नर कामना आवे, पशु मरे दस काज सवारे. लिटरली नरु मीन्स मैन, मरे मीन्स डाइस, पशु मीन्स एन एनिमल, एंड दस काज सवारे मीन्स हैज 10 बेनिफिट्स और यूसेस. Now, the usual meaning provided is that when a man dies, naru mare, he is of no use to man, nar kaam na aave. But when an animal dies, pasu mare, das kaaj savare, it serves 10 purposes. Now, this is what happens when we attempt to understand or explain verses in a vacuum. Yeah? We can think of the following three major problems with such kind of an understanding. Number one, the fact that when a man dies and is of no use to another man, produces no new knowledge. In fact, it produces no useful knowledge at all. No knowledge of any spiritual benefit, definitely. And to suggest that Gurbani is merely stating such superficial information that is already known to all of us is to miss the immense beauty and spiritual genius of Gurbani. The second problem is regarding the point about a dead man serving 10 purposes, and this is equally problematic. We can perhaps count up to 3 or 4, yeah? Firstly, the skin can be used to make things. Secondly, a dead carcass could be used as food. Third, it could be used as fertilizer. Now, someone may be able to add 1 or 2 more, but 10 is still very far away, yeah? Even then, these 3 or 4 uses are applicable only to a certain group of animals. A dead cat or a dead rat, both of which are animals, for instance, can produce none of even the 3 or 4 benefits we mentioned above. Now let's look at the other verses. Yeah, haad jale jaise lakri ka tula, kes jale jaise kaas ka pula. Haad is bones, jale is to burn, lakri ka tula is a pack of sticks, kes is hair, kaas ka pula is a bundle of grass. Again, the usual translation is in terms of the funeral process for a diseased man. That my bones burn like a pack of sticks, haar jale jaise lakri ka tula, and my hair burns like a bundle of grass, kes jale jaise kaas ka pula. Now, beyond the fact that this is also superficial knowledge of no real substantial value, such as translation produces the following two problems. Number one, what about people who don't cremate their dead? Yeah? 3/4 of the earth's dead are buried. So the verse haad jale and kes jale doesn't apply to those billions who do not get cremated. But Gurbani is meant for all. Hence, this cannot be the correct translation. The second problem is, what about people who are cremated but, you know, die without any hair on their head? Again, Gurbani messages should apply to all, with or without hair. So that's four problems we've had so far, yeah? Now, when all these verses are put together, we're going to end up with yet another problem, which is that they are actually very disjointed. They're not connected to each other. What is the connection between a dead animal producing 10 benefits and the hair and bones burning like bundles of woods and twigs? So that's five problems, yeah? The result is we often go back thinking Gurbani is, you know, very disjointed. It's a hodgepodge of verses and doesn't make any holistic kind of a sense. And it is only meant for some people or some groups of people. So, Pyareo, we will be able to solve all these five problems by applying the Rahav principle. Let's look at the Rahav verse now. It reads, Apane karma ki gata, main kya jano baba re Rahav. Apane means my own. Apane karma ki gata. Karma means actions, acts or deeds. Gata main kya jano means I am not in any account of my own actions. I am not in discernment. I am not in measure. I am not in control of my actions. Babare is a cry, you know, a calling out, a spiritual calling out to Guruji for help. Remember, Pyareo, this is the core verse that contains the nucleus idea, the gist, the crux of the message. It must therefore be understood, you know, as much as we can first. So, three messages come out clear from this Rahav verse. First, that actions need to be accounted for. Good deeds need to be maximized and bad deeds eliminated from my life. Now, this message is derived from the words apne karma ki gata. The second message is that due to my inherent weaknesses as a human being, I am unable to do this on my own. So this message is derived from the words gata main kya jano. The third message is that I need assistance, that I need help, that I need blessings from my guru to help me make this accounting. This message is derived from the cry that Bhagat Kabirji is making, main kya jano baba re, meaning I don't know, but you do. Guruji, you do, so please bless me. Now, Pyareo, we apply the understanding derived from the Rahav verse to the first verse, naru mare nar kamana yave, pasu mare das kaj savare. Given that all the key principles in the Rahav verse had to do with karma, meaning deeds or acts or actions, it follows that the words naru and pasu must be looked at in terms of actions. Naru therefore means actions of a good human, actions that reflect humanity, humane activities, deeds that have the fragrance of humanness within them, things done that are useful to mankind, naru. Pasu means just the opposite of naru. Therefore, pasu means actions of an animalistic nature. In Punjabi, pasu puna. Or pasuwa wadiyan kartuta. Just like how Guru Arjan Patsha says in Sukhmani, kartut pasu ki manas jat. Human in name and human in creed, but animalistic in actions and deed. So, the meaning of the verses, naru mare nar kamana yave, pasu mare das kaj sware is, when the actions of a good human within me die, when actions that reflect humanity within me are no more, when I stop performing deeds that have the fragrance of humanness within them, when humanity within me vanishes, naru mare, then I become worthless, nar kamana yave, I become worthless towards both my own spiritual journey as well as to the brotherhood of humanity around me. In Punjabi, jadon mere vichon insaniyat wale karm mar jande ne, insana wale lachan khatam ho jande ne, main phir na apne rohani kam aun yoga rehnda haan, na kise manukhta de. On the other hand, when actions of an animalistic nature, deeds of a lower order, negative acts, they are eliminated from within me, pasu mare, then I am able to be of plentiful use both to my own spiritual journey as well as to others around me. In Punjabi, par duje passe, jadon mere vichon pashupuna naas ho jave, ਪਸ਼ੂ ਮਰੈ, ਜਦੋਂ ਮੇਰੇ ਵਿੱਚੋਂ ਪਸ਼ੂਆਂ ਵਾਲੀਆਂ ਕਰਤੂਤਾਂ ਮਰ ਜਾਣ, ਜਦੋਂ ਮੈਂ ਆਪਣੇ ਆਪ ਵਿੱਚੋਂ ਪਸ਼ੂ ਬਿਰਤੀ ਨੂੰ ਖਤਮ ਕਰ ਲੈਂਦਾ ਹਾਂ, ਦੈਨ ਵਟ ਹੈਪਨਸ ਇਸ ਦਸ ਕਾਜ ਸਵਾਰੇ ਹੈਪਨਸ ਨਾਓ ਦ ਫਰੇਸ ਦਸ ਕਾਜ ਸਵਾਰੇ ਡਸ ਨੋਟ ਮੀਨ 10 ਬੈਨੀਫਿਟਸ ਇਟ ਇਜ਼ ਇਡੀਓਮੈਟਿਕ ਇਟ ਮੀਨਸ ਪਲੈਂਟੀ ਇਟ ਮੀਨਸ ਮੈਕਸੀਮਮ ਇਟ ਮੀਨਸ ਬਾਊਂਟੀਫੁੱਲ ਇਨ ਦੀ ਇਡੀਓਮੈਟਿਕ ਸੈਂਸ ਵੀ ਸੇ ਇਨ ਪੰਜਾਬੀ ਆ ਪਿਆਰੇ ਤੂੰ ਭਾਵੇਂ 10 ਵਾਰੀ ਕਹਿ ਦੇ ਤੇਰੀ ਗੱਲ ਕੋਈ ਨਹੀਂ ਮੰਨਣੀ ਉਹ ਇੱਥੇ ਭਾਵੇਂ 10 ਬੰਦੇ ਲੈ ਉਹ ਕੰਮ ਫਿਰ ਵੀ ਠੀਕ ਨਹੀਂ ਹੋਣਾ ਉਹ ਤੂੰ ਭਾਵੇਂ 10 ਚਿੱਠੀਆਂ ਲਿਖ ਦੇ ਉਹਨੇ ਪੜ੍ਹਨੀ ਤਾਂ ਇੱਕ ਵੀ ਨਹੀਂ ਸੋ ਪਿਆਰੇ ਦਾ ਵਰਸਸ ਨਰੂ ਮਰੈ ਨਰ ਕਾਮਨਾ ਆਵੈ ਪਸ਼ੂ ਮਰੈ ਦਸ ਕਾਜ ਸਵਾਰੈ ਆਰ ਨੋਟ ਅਬਾਊਟ ਐਨ ਐਨੀਮਲ ਡਾਇੰਗ ਔਰ ਅ ਹਿਊਮਨ ਪਾਸਿੰਗ ਅਵੇ ਦੇ ਆਰ ਬੋਥ ਅਬਾਊਟ ਐਕਸ਼ਨਸ ਅਬਾਊਟ ਡਿਫਰੈਂਟ ਟਾਈਪਸ ਆਫ ਐਕਸ਼ਨਸ ਅਬਾਊਟ ਓਪੋਜ਼ਿੰਗ ਕਾਇੰਡ ਆਫ ਐਕਸ਼ਨਸ ਹਿਊਮੇਨ ਐਕਸ਼ਨਸ ਵਰਸਿਸ ਐਨੀਮਲਿਸਟਿਕ ਐਕਸ਼ਨਸ ਐਂਡ ਅਬਾਊਟ ਦੀ ਆਊਟਕਮਸ ਆਫ ਦੀਸ ਐਕਸ਼ਨਸ ਟੂ ਆਵਰ ਓਨ ਸਪਿਰਿਚੁਅਲ ਜਰਨੀ ਐਂਡ ਟੂ ਦੋਜ ਅਰਾਊਂਡ ਅਸ ਹਾਊ ਡੂ ਵੀ ਨੋ ਦੇ ਆਰ ਅਬਾਊਟ ਐਕਸ਼ਨਸ ਬਿਕੋਜ਼ ਦਰ ਹਾਊ ਵਰ ਸੇ ਸੋ ਆਪਣੇ ਕਰਮ ਕੀ ਗੱਤ ਮੈਂ ਕਿਆ ਜਾਣੂ ਹਾਊ ਡੂ ਵੀ ਨੋ ਦੇ ਆਰ ਅਬਾਊਟ ਮਾਈ ਐਕਸ਼ਨਸ ਐਂਡ ਨੋਟ ਦੀ ਐਕਸ਼ਨਸ ਆਫ ਸਮਵਨ ਐਲਸ ਬਿਕੋਜ਼ ਦਰ ਹਾਊ ਵਰ ਸੇਸ ਆਪਣੇ ਕਰਮ ਕੀ ਗੱਤ ਵੀ ਵਿਲ ਲੁੱਕ ਐਟ ਦੀ ਰਿਮੇਨਿੰਗ ਵਰਸਿਸ ਆਫ ਦਿਸ ਸ਼ਬਦ ਇਨ ਦ ਨੈਕਸਟ ਆਡੀਓ ਪਿਆਰਿਓ ਹਾਰ ਜਲੇ ਜੈਸੇ ਲੱਕੜੀ ਕਾ ਤੂਲਾ ਕੇਸ ਜਲੇ ਜੈਸੇ ਘਾਸ ਕਾ ਪੂਲਾ ਦਿਸ ਵਰਸਿਸ ਵਿਲ ਬੀ ਐਗਜ਼ਾਮਿਨਡ ਇਨ ਆਡੀਓ 3 ਨਨ ਆਫ ਦਿਸ ਵਰਸਿਸ ਆਰ ਐਨੀਥਿੰਗ ਅਬਾਊਟ ਅ ਫਿਊਨਰਲ ਐਸ ਵੈਲ ਟਿਲ ਦੈਨ ਪਿਆਰਿਓ ਥੈਂਕ ਯੂ ਫੋਰ ਲਿਸਨਿੰਗ ਭੁੱਲ ਚੁੱਕ ਦੀ ਖਿਮਾ ਕਰਨੀ ਵਾਹਿਗੁਰੂ ਜੀ ਕਾ ਖਾਲਸਾ ਵਾਹਿਗੁਰੂ ਜੀ ਕੀ ਫਤਿਹ